You're watching the video sermon podcast of First Baptist Church of Marble Falls, Texas. For almost 130 years, FBCMF has served Marble Falls and the greater Highland Lakes area faithfully through children's programs, youth activities, and adult discipleship. We invite you to join us each and every Sunday morning at 9 and 10:30 a.m. for deep fellowship, rich worship, and a spirit-filled message. For those who find themselves unable to attend on a Sunday morning, we stream those services. Simply visit fbcmf.live during either of our service times to view it. Never miss an archived sermon by subscribing to this podcast on YouTube by visiting youtube.com/fbcmftube. And to learn more about our church or to listen to an audio-only version of this and other sermons, please visit us online at fbcmf.org.
This morning, I have a really simple question for everyone. What do you think is the most dangerous issue facing your Christian life today? I think that for most of you, the greatest danger is not that you're going to be in worship today and then somehow tomorrow, for some reason, you're going to be lured into a very dark life of drugs and debauchery and murder. You're not going to be on 60 Minutes tomorrow, most of you. For most of you, the greatest danger to your Christian life is not that somehow tomorrow you're going to meet some very charismatic person and you're going to be led off to follow a Charles Manson kind of figure and shave your head and live in communal living and worship the devil. For most of you, that's not it at all. The greatest danger that faces most of your Christian lives is not any of those things, but here's what it might be. The greatest danger may be in the very slowly, methodically taking a few steps away from God, just a few little teensy steps every day, drifting away from God slowly, and so that after a long period of time, you're way over here on this side of the wall, and God is way over there, and you're thinking, how did I get so far away from the one that I love? It's the slowly drifting away that you didn't mean for it to happen, but you found yourself in that kind of place, and it's so dangerous to the Christian life. And not just for ours, but apparently it was also dangerous for the lives of the people that the author of Hebrews was speaking to, that he addressed it, which means, y'all, we need to address it. And we need to talk about this issue, the slowly drifting away that can happen to any of us as well. And we need to hold one another accountable. We need to bring it up and talk about it because it is really easy to drift away from God. The idea to drift away from the Lord, Hebrews says, be careful to listen to what you have heard so that you don't drift away. Now, the word drift away is a nautical term, isn't it? It has to do with floating past or just kind of slipping by something. It doesn't happen fast. Drifting isn't a fast thing. It's a very slow, subvert kind of thing. It's the picture of a ship that's been loosened from the dock, and because they're not attached to the dock, they slowly drift out, perhaps to sea. It's the picture of a river that is very slowly, but very consistently, carrying a boat downstream. It's like you look at a stream, you look at a river, and you can hardly even see it's moving when you look at the water itself. But you look at a leaf, perhaps, on that water, and when you look at it in one position, it doesn't even look like it's moving. But when you see it in comparison to all of the things that are standing still, you can tell that very slowly it's moving. I think that's the greatest danger. I think that's a big, big deal. One author who was talking about it said that this kind of drifting away from the Lord is careless. It's gradual, meaning it doesn't happen all at once. You're not just going to be transported into being far away from God. You're taking a lot of little steps to get there. It's gradual. He also said that it's subtle. Whatever life is leading you away, it's not waving its arms big. The temptation is not huge. When the devil tempts us, it's not like he comes to us looking like the devil. If the devil comes to you tempting you, actually looking like the devil, you'd go, ah, and run away because he's horrible. But instead, he comes to you looking drop-dead gorgeous. And he comes to you in a certain way that's very tempting, very subtle, and you take a tiny little step one day, a tiny little step. You don't just jump into his arms, you know, immediately. It's just not how it happens. It's also unintentional, which means you didn't mean for it to happen. You didn't want it to happen. You just found yourself in this horrible place. One of the saddest passages of Scripture is in Judges, and it's talking about Samson. And it says of Samson that the Spirit of God left him. And then it said these words, and Samson didn't even know it. Now, if the Holy Spirit left your life and you no longer felt the power of the Holy Spirit, you no longer felt the conviction of the Holy Spirit, I pray that you would know it. Samson apparently had taken so many steps away from God slowly, slowly, until he got to the point where when the Spirit of God left him, he didn't even know it. You see, that's what we're talking about. It's the slowly moving away from God. Nobody, no Christians who love the Lord set out to drift away. None of you in here want to drift away from the Lord. But if you're not careful, when we're meeting here in a few months, one day you'll be like, oh my goodness, how did I get to this place? Why am I not where God wants me to be? And it's because it happens unintentionally. Nobody wants to do this, but so many Christians unconsciously do. And there's probably many, many reasons why people drift away from the Lord. I'm just going to share with you a few of them. First, I think a lot of Christians drift away from God because of a preoccupation with just life. Preoccupation, that's all the things that this life is giving to you that you have to work on and do. In the book of Mark, Jesus tells a parable of the sower. And the sower is a farmer, and he is just scattering seed. And the Bible says that the seed he's scattering is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so picture it like this. There's the gospel going out. And according to the parable, sometimes the gospel falls on all kinds of soil. Sometimes it falls on soil that's like a beaten down path. And birds just come and fly and pick up the seeds and fly away. So that's one kind of soil. Another kind is very shallow, very rocky soil, kind of like the soil we have here in the hill country. And it says that in that soil, the plant springs up pretty fast, but because the soil is shallow, the roots can't go down very deep. And so the sun comes out and it withers the plant and it dies. And the idea there is there are a lot of Christians who do not have a very deep root in Jesus Christ and his word. And so when trials and difficulties come, which we know that they will, then there are some Christians who just fold like a lawn chair. But then there is another kind of soil that's spoken of in Mark 4, and it is the soil that is good soil, and the seed brings forth a wonderful plant, but it's surrounded by thorns. And the thorns come and it begins to choke out that plant. Now, right after Jesus gave this parable, the apostles go to him and they say, Jesus, what are you talking about? And Jesus begins to explain the different issues and what he was talking about. And when he comes to talking about the issue of the thorny soil, this is what Jesus said. He said, the people who hear the word of God, and they're in this soil where there are a lot of thorns, he said this, and I quote the Lord, the thorns are the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth and the desire for other things. And those things, the worries, the deceitfulness of wealth, the desire for a lot of other things, they come in and they choke out the plant. So in your life, what are your worries? What are your worries that have a potential, the things that preoccupy your mind, and they have a potential to set you, to loosen you from the Lord and set you adrift from God? What are you worried about today? What are you working on in your life? For most of us, the worries of our life are really pretty ordinary stuff, like raising a family, building a practice or building a business, paying your mortgage, getting an education. For teenagers here, it may be all of the extracurricular activities that all of you are working on, all types of things that you're involved in. Now, all of these things, that's just a part of our regular life. You can't escape them. They're always going to be there, and they're not bad. They're really good things. In fact, they're very good. But if you're not careful, All of those things can keep you away from the very best thing. It's the preoccupation with the things of life that can set you adrift from the Lord. You remember the book Good to Great that Jim Collins wrote? He said this, that any leader who wants to do really great needs to be aware of this, that sometimes good is the enemy of great. And sometimes you have to stop doing the things that are good in order to do the very best things. So sometimes the worries of this life are all of the things that you and I do all the time, but it could keep us too busy. It could preoccupy and take our mind and our emotions so much away from the Lord that slowly but surely we start to drift away from God. Over 16 centuries ago, there was a great preacher named John Chrysostom, and he said that men are nailed to life by things. It's kind of like the cross, and you're nailed to it, but the cross of our life are things. It's the preoccupation with all kinds of stuff. Now, folks, the constant struggle that I have, and I think the constant struggle that most of us have, is to keep our priorities where they need to be rather than get them all out of order. I love the story of the old football coach, Bill Curry, and he was coaching NFL teams, but before he started coaching, of course, he played in the NFL, and he played for Vince Lombardi of the Green Bay Packers, and he said that Vince Lombardi always had a particular speech that he would give to all the players on the very first day of practice, and he heard it a lot, so everybody kind of had it memorized, and Lombardi would get all of the players together first day, and he'd say, "Now, boys, it doesn't matter what your priorities have been up until this point. I'm going to tell you what your priorities are from here on." And he said, "Number one is God. Number two is your family. But number three is the Green Bay Packers." And then Bill Curry said that Lombardi took us out on the practice field, and he got all of those priorities very mixed up. It's easy, though, isn't it? I think it's easy to do in this world. I see some of you struggling with it. And I'm not guessing about that. I know. And I struggle with it in my own life, the preoccupation with life that causes us to drift. But God makes a promise that if we'll seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, then all these other things will be added unto us as well. But when secondary things, whether it's careless or gradual or subtle or unintentional or however it happens, when secondary things begin to receive primary attention in our life, and then we know that we are set up to be loosened from the dock and begin to drift away from our Lord. Here's another one. People begin to drift away from God because of trouble and trials and crises that happen in your life. Y'all, it's a fact that a crisis never leaves you where it found you. We're different after it happens to us. A crisis will either make you better or bitter. It makes some of us. It breaks other people. Crisis can shake your faith and set you adrift from God and the Lord. Or, it doesn't have to, or a crisis could bring you closer to the Lord. It could tie you closer to the dock of Jesus Christ. But we get so terrified of bad things happening to us. Some of you have had bad things happen in your life, and you have never been the same since. Your relationship with the Lord has never been the way that it was 5 years ago or 10 years ago. And if you look back to that moment, the only thing that you can think, what was it? What was that issue, that bad thing that happened, and it set you adrift, and you've never been able to get back to where you were for some reason. Some of you are better because of a crisis, but not all of you. There may be some of us that are still struggling in bitterness and all kinds of things because sometimes a crisis sets you adrift and you can begin to move away from the Lord. Richard Haverson said, "Difficulties make some men, but they break others." Now, here's the funniest thing, though. I have noticed that the exact opposite of that is also very true. Some people drift away from the Lord, not because of trials and difficulty. Some people drift away from the Lord because of success and prosperity. Don't y'all think that's interesting? I think it's incredibly ironic that perhaps the one thing that is worse than troubles in life is the lack of troubles. That sometimes it's when people get everything and they're very successful, and that will make them, you know, begin to drift away from the Lord. It's when you're on your knees saying, Lord, things aren't going well. I need your help. But all of a sudden, God gives you the help. You start doing well. I mean, you're kicking tail. You're making money. Your relationships are good. You're winning. And you stop getting on your knees praying for some reason. Deuteronomy 8 is a passage that gives commentary to this kind of idea, because the Israelites were just about to go into the promised land, and they had been through horrible things, horrible. And they're just about to go into a land, and it's going to be great for them. But God knows it's going to be a lot better than slavery, a lot better than the wilderness. And so in Deuteronomy 8, God tells Moses this: be sure and tell all of the people that when they get into the new land, and I've given it to them, and they have built their houses, and they're happy, and they've eaten, and they're satisfied, tell them then to be careful not to forget who I am. Y'all, you would think that you'd get into the promised land, and you get a little bit of success and a little prosperity, and things are going well, that you draw closer to the Lord because you remember where he brought you. But sometimes we forget who we are. Sometimes we forget all that the Lord has done. And there are people who lose God in success and prosperity. George W. Truett said, if a man can stand prosperity, he can stand just about anything. There was a show called Queens, and Alex Haley, who did the show Roots, also did a made-for-television kind of mini-series called Queens. And in it, he tells the story of a very poor Irish immigrant named James Jackson. And James Jackson was just in complete poverty, living in filth. It was a horrible life. And so he made his way as an immigrant to the United States, and he went to Florence, Alabama. When he got to Alabama, he began to be a plantation, grow a plantation, and he became a plantation owner, and he had slaves. Now, Mr. Jackson was kind of sympathetic to the plight of slaves, but he kept them. He didn't fight for their freedom. He didn't do anything like that for them to try to help them in their situation. And in one very moving scene in Queens, he said this: I fought against England when they tried to enslave the Irish. But then I came here and I got rich and I forgot who I was. C.S. Lewis said, the years of prosperity are excellent campaigning weather for the devil. And remember this, you remember the church that got the greatest criticism in the book of Revelation, the church of Laodicea? In the church of Laodicea, man, they weren't being persecuted. Laodicea, they were doing well. They had everything going for them. In fact, if you ask the church in Laodicea in Revelation, when it talks about them, they were to say this. If you said, well, how are y'all doing as a church, First Baptist Laodicea? Then Laodicea would say this. They'd hold out their arms and say, man, we are rich. We have done well. We are successful in ministry. We have acquired. We don't need a single thing. But Jesus Christ's assessment of that church was very different from their own assessment. Jesus looked at him and he says, no. You're wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked, and I am tempted to spit you out of my mouth. Now, I say all of this because, y'all know what? Of all the churches that it speaks of in the book of Revelation, probably the one that we're the most tempted to be like would probably be Laodicea, because God has blessed us incredibly, don't you think? I mean, incredibly. We have more than so many churches around the world, so many churches in our own community. If there is any temptation for you and I probably to drift away from the Lord, I'm telling you, this could probably be it at some level, because we have been given so much. And in the book of Revelation, when it's talking to the Laodicean church that has so much, it has this awkward moment where Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. Now, he is not, in that context, Jesus isn't standing at the door knocking to the lost world. He's not saying, it's not an evangelistic kind of thing. Now, it works for evangelism that Jesus knocks on the door of people who don't know him. Absolutely. But in that context, that story, that illustration, picture of Jesus knocking, he's knocking on the door of a church to Laodicea. Behold, I stand at the door of your church and I'm knocking. And if anybody in the church will open the door and let me in, I'm going to come in and eat with you. Well, here's my question. How in the world did Jesus find himself on the outside of the church? Why is he standing knocking rather than being inside with everybody? Because I think the reason is you can get to a point where you're so successful that you can begin to drift away from the Lord. And you have to be very, very careful about that. Prosperity made some people forget God and forget who they were in the Lord. But that's not all. I think some people drift away not only for those reasons, but also because they get very disappointed with Christians. Some people get very disappointed with churches. They've been hurt by a church. They've been hurt by a Christian, a deacon, a Sunday school teacher, and they're hurt, and they're mad, and they're disappointed, and they've begun to be disillusioned. And because of that, they say, y'all know what? All this Christianity stuff can't be real, because if it was real, then I wouldn't be treated the way that I'm treated. And so they say, we're out. We're out because it's not worth it. I don't see that it's worth it. All I see when I look at the church is just hypocrites everywhere. Now, y'all probably run into Christians who are a little bit like that. I've met some Christians who are so rigid that they would take the circle of the sun and they'd square it up if they could. Some Christians are so rigid that they'd flatten the rainbow if they could. Will Rogers made a comment about them, and he said, they are the kind of good people that give good a bad name. There are some Christians even that they're just so mean that if they were in a fight with lions, I'd have to root for the lions, because I think the lion's going to lose, probably, in it. And you know, we laugh a little bit about it, but it gets sad when you think of what the rest of the world does when they look at Christians like that and look at churches like that. A long time ago, Jay Leno was commenting on this kind of thing, and Jay Leno said this: have you ever noticed that there are some people who claim that they have been born again, but you wish that they had never been born the first time? Have you ever encountered a kind of Christian and you're like, oh my goodness, I'd rather hang out with somebody who's lost than with that kind of person? The way that they act, what they say, what they do, the way that they look at the world, the way that they look at themselves, it is so unbecoming of who Jesus Christ is that it can chase you completely away. I think that when people encounter that, what it could do is set them adrift from the Lord. And I've seen more hypocrisy among leaders, pastors and leaders, than anyone else. And I'm not talking about making a mistake here, guys. Everybody makes mistakes, so I'm not talking about that. What I am talking about is somebody who is very selfish and intentionally is so selfish, and they want their ideas more than everybody else's to succeed, that they just run roughshod over everybody else, and they justify it because they think that this is God's will. But is it worth it if you kill everybody getting to that? And is it really God's will if you have to hurt everybody getting to it? Well, I get fed up, not in this church, but I hear it, and I'm serious about that. I'm not talking about anybody or anything here. But I've experienced this in my past, a kind of sweet meanness. Sweet meanness. It's the kind of people that are really, really sweet, really just, you know, sugar plum sweet kind of Christians, but they're passive aggressive. And they come around, man, and they get you. Boom. The kind of sweet meanness that happens. Well, when it happens to some Christians and they're on the receiving end of that kind of thing, it makes them drift away from the Lord. Have any of you ever seen that happen to somebody? that you meet them, well, why don't you go to church? Who, you know, and they say, well, because of this and because of that. Well, that's not the only reason. Here's a great reason why people drift away from the Lord. Some people drift away because over the years, they have made so many moral and ethical and sinful compromises with the ideas of the world that they've gotten so far away that they have become comfortable with sin. It doesn't seem like sin anymore. A sin isn't uncomfortable, but it is comfortable because they've lived in it for so long. This past week, Barney Sarver and I, he's the leader of our men's ministry, we're talking about this idea of being callous to sin, that at first, you know, you like working in a garden, man, you get a blister and it hurts, but you just keep working at it and you develop a callus and it doesn't hurt you anymore. And if you sin a little and then a little and a little bit more, you can get so comfortable with it, guys. So comfortable that sin doesn't bother you. You say whatever you want to say. You act how you want. And there is no conviction anymore because we've built up such a wall in our heart to this thing called conviction. We've just gotten used to it. I want you to know that if you've gotten just a little bit okay with a little sin here or a little sin here, then you are beginning to untie your rope from the dock and you are beginning to drift away. If you're even a little bit okay with immorality or unethical behavior and sin. And so what do? We need to keep tied to the harbor, tied to the dock. And we've talked about all of these reasons why some people drift away from the Lord, but what we haven't talked about is, well, Ross, what do I do to keep it from happening? And so here are some ways you can keep it from happening. Simply do what the writer of Hebrews is telling us to do. He says, be careful. Be careful. Pay attention to what you have heard. Pay attention. You need to take a good look at yourself, and I have to take a good look at myself and make a spiritual, emotional evaluation of where I am in relation to God. You ask all of the am I questions. Am I in love with God? Am I praying to the Lord? Am I sharing my life with people around me? Am I doing these things? Am I being generous? And am I being selfless? Am I serving people? Am I doing those things? Here's what it comes down to, am I doing all of the things that a vibrant, on fire for the Lord Christian ought to be doing? And so you have the am I moment. Now, once you have that, then the next step is very important because you can say, am I doing these things? And then when you say, no, I'm not, then you can begin to make an excuse for yourself of why you're not doing it. You can say, am I as in love with the Lord as I need to be? Well, no, I'm not. Well, and the reason that I'm not is because so-and-so. The reason that I'm not is because I'm just too busy. Or the reason that I'm not is because of all that. And so then what you'll do is all of these reasons that I've already mentioned about why people begin to drift away from the Lord, there are some Christians who will do the self-evaluation and say, am I where I need to be? No, I'm not. But then they're going to use all of that in a way that justifies drifting away from God. To say, for instance, in the idea of some people drift away from the Lord because of disappointment with others. So someone will say, am I where I need to be? Well, no, I'm not. Well, why not? Well, the reason is because I'm disappointed with this other person over here. Let me tell you, I did list all of these reasons why people drift away from God, but let me say, not a single one of them is justifiable. They're just reasons. They're common reasons so that you can be aware of them, not justify drifting away from God because of them. You have to take personal responsibility for where you are in your walk with God. And if you say, you know what, I'm where I am because of all those hypocrites over there, and that's why I am where I am. Let me offer to you the story of Matthias and Judas. You remember Judas betrays Jesus Christ. He's one of the 12, and he hangs himself, and he's gone. So when the church begins in the book of Acts, they need somebody to replace Judas. And they vote, and they all vote on this guy named Matthias. Hey, Matthias, you get to replace Judas. How about that? I'm so glad that Matthias, when they say, hey, we want you to be one of us, buddy. Come on into the 12. And I'm glad that Matthias didn't say, are you joking? I've seen how you apostles are. I've seen how Judas was. I know about you, Peter, you know, doing all the things. You guys are the worst. I don't want to have anything to do with y'all. I'm going to follow Jesus, all right, but I just don't want to be a part of all that. That's one way Matthias could have been, but I'm very grateful that he stood up, and here's what he did. He took the place of Judas. If you know anybody in the Christian life, in the kingdom of God, or in our church, and they're not who they need to be in Jesus Christ, rather than becoming disappointed with them, or mad at them, or justifying why you have drifted away because of them, instead of any of that, say, you know what? I'm going to take their place. The way that Matthias took Judas's place, you can stand up. If there's been anybody who's ever hurt you, then you can stand up and you can say, I'm going to draw close to the Lord, and I'm going to take that person's place. And I'm going to take responsibility because it's mine to take. So don't blame anybody else when you ask the am I questions. Whatever you come to, take responsibility for where you are. And that way you can begin to get back. And the only way to get back then is to row like mad. That's the only way. The only way to keep from drifting is to keep on rowing, y'all. You have to. Let me tell you this. The prize doesn't wait downstream. The prize for us waits upstream. And there's only one way to get upstream, and that is to row for it. We row for the prize. You're going to move downhill. You'll move downstream by doing nothing. You don't have to do anything bad. You don't have to put the accelerator on. If my car were up on a hill and I'm facing downhill, and I'm going, I don't have to push the accelerator to go down the hill. All I have to do is just sit back. My car's going to go down the hill. In the same way, you don't have to do anything necessarily bad to drift away from God. You don't have to go out and hurt people and tell lies. All you have to do to drift away from God is just don't row toward Him. When you don't row toward Him, you're going to drift away from Him. You know what? If you don't have Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, do you know what you have to do in order to stay lost? Just keep up exactly where you are. Don't let anything shake you or move you. You just keep it up. You don't have to go out and do something bad in order to stay lost. You don't have to do anything bad to drift away from God. You just do nothing, and you will. And so to be a Christian, though, we're commanded to row upstream. Y'all, don't let anything drift you away from God. Move toward Him, because first, your life depends on it. But not just yours, but your family's life and your church's life. All of these things depend on you rowing toward the Lord. And so together and with me, would all of you commit to refusing to just drift along with the current and instead row toward God, to be aware of where you are, to take responsibility for where you are, and row with ramming speed. Ramming speed, we row uphill, because the Bible does say that when we row toward the Lord, the gates of hell will not be able to stand against a gospel-filled church. And so we row toward that. I hope that you will. There might be some of you, and you've drifted away from the Lord. And God is calling you back. He's calling you back. I'll finish with this. There were two boys, and they were wanting to get away from church, wanting to get away from everything. And so one of them says to the other one, they live near a coast, and they said, let's get on our horses and let's skip church and let's just get away from it as fast as we can. They were sick and tired of their parents making them go. They're sick and tired of all the things that happen. And so they start riding their horses down the beach away from church as fast as they can. And all the while in the background, it's you know, in the morning, and the church bells are beginning to ring. But the further they get away, the quieter the church bells get. The quieter the church bells get, but they're still ringing. And finally, one of the boys stops his horse, and his buddy says, what are you doing? Let's go, man. Let's go. And his friend says to him, "No, I think I'm going to turn around while I can still hear the bells ringing. The bells are ringing. Don't drift away from the Lord. Don't drift away. I love you very, very much."
You've been watching the video sermon podcast of First Baptist Church of Marble Falls, Texas. Never miss an archived sermon by subscribing to this podcast on YouTube by visiting youtube.com/FBCMFTube. And to learn more about our church or to listen to an audio-only version of this and other sermons, please visit us online at fbcmf.org.